300 million years ago, the land on Earth became a living nightmare that lasted 50 million years. The beasts that roamed Pangaea were some of the strangest things to ever kill on the planet. This was a time when the ocean was safer than land. This was the Permian hellscape.
Hi, I'm Danielle Defoe, and you're watching Paleologic. We're taking a look at one of the scariest times to be alive in our green Earth's long history, the Permian. Before the dinos took over the Earth, these uncanny-looking species ruled the planet with an iron jaw.
One of the first megapredators to appear was the Dimetrodon, about 298 million years ago. Long serrated teeth and an unmistakable back sail make it one of the icons of the Permian. Dimetrodon appeared at a time of rapid species radiation. Their prey was adapting to the New World too. The Carboniferous, the geological period before the Permian, had been a time of rain. The world was dominated by swamps and rainforests. The air had significantly more oxygen than it does today. So invertebrates and amphibians grew large and thrived.
During the Permian, the supercontinent got significantly drier, and animals that could lay eggs on land took over. Our ancestors at the time weren't even mammals yet, but were starting to colonize the globe. And while they were doing that, Dimetrodon was probably eating them.
Permian predators and prey were in an arms race, getting bigger and stronger. The oldest known Dimetrodon was just about 1.25 meters long, but by 280 million years ago, they had almost quadrupled their size, reaching lengths of up to 4.5 meters. The purpose of the sail is still a bit of a mystery. The most widely accepted theories are that it was a thermoregulation structure, similar to the large ears of elephants. Blood would flow into the sail and cool down before coming back into the animal's core.
This makes sense because the largest Dimetrodon were about as long as hippos and as heavy as black bears. But it could have also been used for sexual selection or to intimidate other Dimetrodon. If you saw a Dimetrodon with a huge colorful sail, you could bet your last dollar that it was a healthy guy. Females would love him and males would fear him as much as their prey.
This was probably also true for other sailed species of the early Permian. Predators like Sphenacodon, which were built like bull terriers, had a much smaller sail, and it was like a constant signal of its danger.
If you've ever seen a video of a dogfight, you know you wouldn't want to be anywhere near them. The small prey of the Sphenacodon basically lived in a kennel of rabid dogs.
There were also sailed herbivores, like Edaphosaurus. This ancient beast's sail spines had crossbars, suggesting a thick sail that could withstand attacks from some of its predators. Dimetrodons might have targeted these large chunks of meat for a delicious but dangerous meal. These vegetarians could be over 3 meters long, and battles between them made the Earth tremble.
Some scientists have wondered, what if the sail was used for sailing? These animals were close to the ground and superficially built kind of like Komodo dragons, but we don't have any evidence suggesting that they were good swimmers. The limbs don't seem to be made for paddling, and the tail wouldn't give the propulsion that, say, a crocodile's tail does. But we're still learning about them, and who knows? We might find a more amphibious species.
After the time of the Dimetrodons, the planet got even drier, and other, more mammal-like synapsids took over. One of the greatest ones was Anteosaurus. They appeared about 265 million years ago, and for 5 million years, they were the kings of the world. At 5 meters long and 600 kilograms, they were the size of hippos. They also had a reinforced skull, maybe to headbutt each other like rams, and massive fangs to tear the flesh off the bones of other Permian beasts.
Because of their gigantic size, they were initially thought to be scavengers, But as we know from modern-day hippos, enormous animals can be quick too. X-rays on Anteosaurus' skulls suggest that their brains were meant for great balance and coordination, similar to today's land predators. So yes, if you saw one of these in the Permian, it was probably the last thing you ever saw.
Rivers, streams, and swamps weren't safe either. If you tried to escape an Anteosaurus by running into some water, you'd quickly get ambushed by a 100-kilo Rhinesuchus. These amphibian temnospondyls were mostly predators of aquatic animals. They had a palate covered in sharp teeth to hang on to fish and other swimming prey. But these croc frogs could also easily hide in the water and catch anything that got close enough for an ambush. Kinda like this.
But the real screaming part of the nightmare started in the late Permian, when saber-toothed beasts took over the Pangean landscape. These were the Gorgonopsids.
These saber-toothed cat Komodo hybrids were the undisputed kings of the late Permian. Unlike some of the other predators which learned to survive in the desert, most large Gorgonopsids lived in the far north and far south of Pangaea. These were massive steppes with giant herbivores. To kill them, in many species, their canines gradually got larger until they reached about 15 centimeters in length, about the size of an average-sized banana.
Eating while having banana-sized teeth sticking out of their jaw was, what we call in the scientific community, a huge hassle. So Gorgonopsids could open their jaws up to 90 degrees. They could basically stab you to death and then swallow you whole.
In the land that eventually became modern-day Russia lived Inostrancevia, the beast of the north. This was the largest Gorgonopsian. Their skull was about the size of a grizzly bear's head. They were also about the same weight as Yogi Bear, but from a distance, they looked more like a 3.5-meter-long saber-toothed wolf lizard.
Really, nature wasn't pulling any punches. If you had to design an animal to be as scary and lethal as possible, you'd have a hard time coming up with something as metal as Inostrancevia. The combination of size, speed, and killing tools was simply unmatched.
In the south, in what is now South Africa, Rubidgea Atrox ruled. The largest specimen ever found was just a few inches smaller than the largest Inostrancevia, but there's a decent chance that they could get larger and usurp the throne for largest Gorgonopsian of all time. And if that wasn't enough, other smaller members of the family, like Smilesaurus, were equally lethal. This species in particular had the largest canines relative to body size of all Gorgonopsians. And despite being dwarfed by the other species, they were massive. They could be up to 2 meters long, about the same size as a jaguar, but with even longer teeth.
Encounters with any of these predators were not survivable. We would have been the easiest prey of their lives. After all, it would have made no sense for them getting that big and powerful unless they needed to catch mighty prey. And yep, even the herbivores were terrifying in the Permian.
Scutosaurus was the iconic herbivore of the Permian, at 3 meters long and weighing in at 1 ton. It was a heavyweight armored tank with hard bony plates which in some areas turned into small spikes. It's unclear if it mostly lived on land or water, but wherever it roamed, it commanded the same respect as a wrecking ball. Dicynodonts had keratin beaks to cut off vegetation and tusks to defend themselves. Yes, they were reptile-like mammal relatives with some bird features. Why not? Of course, having to fight off the terrible predators of the time, they had to have a powerful bite and very thick skin. Some species, like Lissowisia, got to be larger than a rhino.
Yeah, the line between reptiles and the species that eventually evolved into mammals was grayer than you'd expect. Whenever you do something silly or out of pocket, just remember, we're all descendants of weirdos. It's okay.
We could spend all day talking about all the hundreds of species that made the Permian the scariest time to be alive on land. But we're still just starting to understand it, and there's a lot yet to be discovered.
Next time we make an episode about the Permian, there will be new amazing creatures to talk about. And that's the beauty of paleontology. There's always new discoveries to keep us fascinated about the world that once was. So, what should we talk about next? Please let me know in the comments, and don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching, and see ya! Hey everyone, we have exciting news! We're thrilled to announce the release of Animalogic's very first book, Strange Creatures. This book dives into the most incredible animals we've ever featured on the show, with each chapter packed with my illustrations and stunning full-color images. It's a fun and engaging way to learn about the animal kingdom, and a perfect tool to spark kids' interest in science. Each chapter breaks down an animal's biology, behavior, and all the coolest facts you need to know about these fascinating creatures. Animalogic's Strange Creatures is a must-have addition to your own library, or the perfect gift for an animal lover this upcoming holiday season. Click the link in the description to check it out, and if you can, pre-order a copy. Pre-ordering would help us get an extra bump in the Amazon algorithm, and that would mean the world to us, so thank you so much.